morning, Sanbonani, Saubona, Bongia, and welcome to our Sunday service. My name is Peter Kituri from Kenya, but I'm coming to you from Cape Town to the Southern Africa Churches of Christ. It's truly wonderful to have you with us this morning, and I hope that you have a wonderful time listening to the service, but also singing and just worshiping with us. Why don't we bow our heads and start the service with a prayer? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning just thankful that we have this opportunity to come and worship you. Lord, even though we may not be sitting next to one another, we do know that we are with each other in spirit, and we know that we have this opportunity to just worship with you and connect with you. Lord, I pray that you'll be with everyone that is involved with this service and be with everyone that is also listening and watching. I pray that you'll continue to meet each of us at our point of need and just allow us to connect and just be moved by the words that we hear and the worship that that we experience. Father, we love you, and it's in your Son's name we pray. Amen.
All right. Are you ready to praise the name of the Lord? Come on. Sing, oh, oh, oh.
Lord, you are good, save.
Lord, you are good, save.
Lord, Onde não é Jesuá?
Onde não é Jesuá? Onde não é Jesuá? Onde não é
my heart has been comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe to you, I owe to you. Here, my hope is found here, on holy ground. Here I bow down, here I bow down. Here, arms open wide, here, you saved my life. Here I bow down, here I bow. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you, 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 Jesus.
Hi there, everyone, and greetings from Cape Town, and a special shout out to Irene Renton, my sister-in-law, on her birthday today. So here's the thing. We all have a picture. And when I say picture, I'm not talking about this kind of picture. I'm talking about the picture that you have in your head about the way that things are supposed to work out. That picture of how financially stable you are supposed to be. Maybe you have a picture in your head of what your relationships should look like, where you should be in kind of life stages, what kind of job satisfaction you should be having, what kind of family should be around you. We have this picture in our mind of the way that things are supposed to be. And we can often spend the rest of our lives fighting to try and make that picture happen. And we can spend most probably the majority of that fighting time actually sitting there and saying, wait a minute, this is not working out the way that I pictured it. I mean, think about it. Any death, any disappointment, any time you go through a financial kind of downturn, emotional challenges, physical challenges, I mean, you name it, any time something doesn't go well, we can sit there and say, but wait a minute, this is not the way that I pictured it. This is not the way that it's supposed to be. It's messing with my picture. And in Cape Town over the last couple of weeks, we've been really looking at this theme of not the way that I pictured it. And we've looked at Joseph, we looked at David, and you can find those on the Cape Town Church YouTube channel. But today we're going to read about a family that had to deal with a real tragedy. And to be honest, we're going to read about one of the craziest things that Jesus ever did. And Jesus did some pretty crazy stuff. And when I say crazy things, if you're into science fiction, you agree with me that you should not be messing with the space-time continuum. And yet Jesus was kind of, you know, was playing one of those games. I mean, yes, come and tell parables. Absolutely love a good parable. Turn water into wine. That's pretty cool. But to raise someone from the dead, that's like on a whole different category of miracle and cool stuff. And yet that's exactly what Jesus did in this situation. And it all started with Jesus making friends with this family, right? And there were two sisters, Mary and Martha. You might have heard or read about them before. And they had a brother, Lazarus. And this family, they lived in a little town just outside of Jerusalem. And what happened was that Jesus, whenever he'd be in Jerusalem, that wasn't his kind of hometown, but he spent some time there. He would visit them. He would stay with them. It was a little bit like a home away from home. And he'd build a good relationship with this family. And you might remember certain scenarios. There was a time when he was actually doing kind of a house church at their home. And Martha, the older sister, you know, kind of complained to him a little bit about her sister. And, hey, Jesus, speak to my sister. She's not helping prepare the food. And so, you know, it was that family. And you might also remember Mary. She was the one that just before Jesus' crucifixion, she wiped his feet with her hair. So we're talking about a family that Jesus was close to and that he knew pretty well. And anyway, so what happened was Lazarus, the brother, gets sick, right? He gets sick. And Jesus was out. He'd left Jerusalem. The authorities had tried to stone him. So he was like, hey, I'm out of here. And Mary and Martha, they see that their brother's sick. And they send a message to Jesus to say, hey, Jesus, listen, you know, this is a tragedy. Things are not looking. We're not talking about a cough here. He's really not looking good. Please, can you come back and try and help us? And what happened was Jesus, he gets this message. And his disciples are like, Jesus, you must be kidding. I mean, you can't really think about going back in the direction of Jerusalem. And Jesus, he, you know, against their advice, he decides to head back, and he literally takes his time. He waits an extra 2 days. He doesn't rush back. He takes his time, and while he was taking his time, Lazarus died. And this did not play out the way that Mary and Martha had pictured it, right? I mean, they was like, hey, we know Jesus. Jesus can do amazing things. We've sent message. I hope or I believe that he'll get this message. He'll come back. Maybe he can heal Lazarus. He dies. Not the way they pictured it. I mean, maybe they had a picture in their mind, growing old together. You know, I mean, this was their brother during those times. Most probably their protector as well. Possibly even a breadwinner. We don't know, but... you know, this was pretty serious stuff. And you know, if I had to be honest, I mean, this is the kind of thing that really haunts me. I mean, I'm okay with lots of things happening. My soccer team loses from time to time, and I'm okay with all of that. But what haunts me is my wife and my kids dying. I mean, that just you know, if I just can't even describe to you how much that haunts me. And you know, I get panicky about it, and Moore and I, we sometimes talk, and we're like, okay, so we obviously at some point are going to die, but maybe the best thing would be if we all just died in a plane accident together, then we all kind of die together, and no one has to miss anyone else, And you know, I did think about that a little bit afterwards, and I thought, you know, that's probably not that kind, because what about the other passengers, right? But you know, there's this picture that I have of how I want things to be. And whenever that picture gets threatened, I get panicky, I get sad, I get desperate. And, you know, I think we've all got those stories, right? We've all got those situations, either things that you've got that you don't want to lose, or they're things that you don't have that you desperately want, right? There's those stories, those pictures that we have, and those times that we've prayed, we've thrown up our hands, we've sent that message to Jesus to come and help us. In the same way that Mary and Martha sent a message to Jesus, Jesus, please come and help us. We've got a situation, and yet not getting the result you wanted. You've got those situations, I'm sure you do. And you have a look at what happens here. So Lazarus has now been dead for a couple of days by the time Jesus enters town. Okay, and I don't know exactly what Jesus must have been feeling, but he walks into Bethany, and this is not a big city, this is a small town. He walks in after Lazarus has been dead for 4 days, And Mary and Martha have obviously been mourning. And the Bible talks about how there were other people there to comfort them during that time. And Martha kind of gets up. She hears that Jesus is in town. She gets up. She runs out to go and meet him as he is now entering Bethany. And she said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. If you had been here, Jesus, if you had got this right, if you had listened, if you had been here sooner, my brother would not have died." I mean, she was feeling it all right. I mean, there was blame. If you had been here, there was discouragement. Maybe even kind of feeling a little bit betrayed. I mean, you sense the anger in her voice. You know, Jesus, you could have pitched up and fixed my picture. You could have pitched up, and yet you didn't. You could have fixed this. And one can have those feelings about Jesus sometimes, can't we? I mean, you know, you can help me, so why don't you? You know, you can help me find a job. Jesus, I know you can. God, I know you can help me find a job. I know you can help me get through this scenario. I know that you can help me find a spouse or find a boyfriend or a girlfriend or have a child. I know that you can. Why don't you? I'm asking, why weren't you here? That's what Jesus is saying. What Martha's saying to him. And there's some good news in this story, and I'm going to give you a little bit of a window into how the story ends, that Jesus is going to physically heal and raise Lazarus from the dead. Okay, spoiler alert. That is going to happen. But there's also some bad news in the story, is that Lazarus is going to die again. Yep, Jesus is going to raise him, and then eventually he's going to die again. He's going to have to go through that twice. And it really gets you thinking a little bit about blessings, doesn't it? I mean, we can get so fixated on what we believe our blessings should be, and this physical situation that we want to change, that we can forget that our picture, that situation, is not where our hope is meant to come from. And while we're begging God to change the picture, we lose sight of what this is all supposed to be about in the end. And I can't lie, I struggle a lot with wanting to be the center of my story. I'm going to show you a little bit of a picture of what I struggle with here. Is I think about my life a whole lot. I live my life, I wake up, I breathe, I see, I've got things going on, I've got work, I've got family, I've got church, I've got my relationship. I mean, life feels busy. And what happens to me is, if I'm not careful, I can put myself at the center of everything that's going on around me. And that actually feels kind of normal to me. It kind of, I'm living my life and I'm the center of my life. But what I won't do is I won't go around telling you this, right? I mean, it kind of sounds a little bit arrogant for me to kind of walk around saying, "Hey, listen, I'm the center of my life. I'm the center of my story." But think about your prayers. I mean, God, please, you know, help me to get more money. Help me to have more money so that I can be more financially secure. Or God, help my work situation to change. Or help my family to change. Or church is not suiting me right now. Help that to change, to orientate more towards me. And I think that this kind of selfish kind of view of the world, of time, is a real challenge. Because what happens when these things don't work out the way that I want them to? What happens when it feels like God is not pitching up the way I pictured it? Or if money is not working out the way that I'd planned? Or people, all of a sudden, instead of being surrendered, I feel betrayed. feel betrayed by church, betrayed by God, betrayed by work, and it creates a very strange scenario, and it creates a conflict in my heart. And you know, it must have been haunting for Martha in that moment to know that Jesus could have helped her, but he didn't. And you notice that Martha isn't doubting God's power. She's just doubting his timing. You could have showed up, but you didn't. And I think that's worth noting, because I believe when we put ourselves at the center of the story, that's where our emotional issues can really start to play with our mind. And you know, the question isn't, can you trust God? Of course you can trust God. The question is, are you willing to wait? Or even more so, are you willing to get a no? That's the question. See, the problem with seeing this picture is this picture will set you up for a life of heartbreak. Because the reality is, this is not how things work, as much as I can feel like I want it to be that way. And when things aren't working out, we blame, we get angry, we manipulate. And you know what? Maybe we even lose faith. God, I would be happier if you just pitched up more, and I can't do this anymore. We blame and we lose faith. So Jesus says to Martha, I mean, she comes and she's like, Jesus, you really messed up here. And Jesus says to her in John 11, I'm the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? You know, your purpose and my purpose in life is not to be physically blessed. Is it nice to be physically blessed? Absolutely. But our purpose is not to get the dream picture. You are part of the resurrection and the life. That is the bigger picture. And so I'm going to show you a slightly different diagram that is the real story. And it looks a little bit something like this, where when it comes to the way that the universe is working, God is at the center of everything. Now, am I a joy to God? Am I a prized possession, a jewel in his crown? Oh, absolutely. But I'm not the center of the story. He's the center of the story. And while I'm spending so much time thinking about myself, he's thinking about all things present, all things past, all things future. He's thinking about his family, his divine purposes, all of humanity, and yes, some other people. He is the center. And you know what? If we love our plans, then I've got some bad news for us. That our plans are not the plan. God's plans are the plan. That for this life to make its way to, for his life to make its way to every corner of the earth, that's the plan. For the resurrection to be experienced by everyone, that's the plan. Not for me to get my wish. And in fact, my happiest place will actually be letting go of my picture. Saying, you know what, God, this is my picture, and it's okay to have a picture. It's nice to, you know, I've got a dream, I've got a vision, I've got wishes and desires, and you made me to have those things, absolutely. But you know what? I'm going to put that picture down, and if I get some of it, great. But if I don't get some of it, I'm okay. Because that is not the center of the story. God's purposes are the center of the story. And if I can embrace that, that's where I'm going to be happy. And you know what? Maybe you are not meant to have certain things. What I'm saying is, don't give up, But don't attach your faith to those things. Maybe life is really hard. Hang in there. Hang in there. You know, Mary and Martha, they were not the first people to be left waiting for God to act. It's one story, but the Bible's full of narratives and stories about people waiting on God. Sometimes waiting months, sometimes waiting years, sometimes waiting forever. I mean, think about David, Abraham, Moses, Enoch, Joseph, Samuel. I mean, the Hebrew writer said it so beautiful, and I'm gonna show you the passage now. All these people were still living by faith when they died. Death is not the end. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance, admitting that they were foreigners and strangers on earth. People who say such things show that they are looking for a country of their own. If they'd been thinking of the country they had left, they would have had the opportunity to return. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. You know, circumstance needs to play a lesser role in our life, and the Holy Spirit needs to play a greater role. And I'm not talking about denial. I'm not talking about fake smiles. I'm talking about a deep sense of the only thing that really matters is God's purposes. And there'll be times when that will be clear. There'll be times when that won't be clear at all. And there is a good chance that in my lifetime, I may never see or know what they are exactly. You know, in the end, Jesus raised Lazarus. And it's the only time that I'm aware of, that we're aware of, that he did something like that during his ministry, that he actually raised someone from the dead. But you'll realize that the story was actually not about Lazarus, not about him at all. And it wasn't even about kindness to Mary and Martha. Yes, they cried. Yes, and they ran to him and said, Jesus, you could have helped and you didn't. And he ended up raising Lazarus from the dead. But it wasn't about kindness to them, because it would kind of be strange if it was about kindness to them. Because what about all the other people that didn't get their loved ones raised? I mean, you know, how do you figure that? What about his own disciples and their families? Did they get the same miracle? I mean, you know, if it was about Lazarus and it was about kindness to Mary and Martha, it would be a little bit strange. And to be honest, I got a feeling that Lazarus might even have been a little bit upset, right? I mean, if you've seen any horror movie, you will know that mummies do not like to be raised from the crypt. Okay, so you can assume that Lazarus wanted to be raised. There's a chance maybe he didn't want to be woken. But you know what? Jesus actually explained why he was going to do this before he even came to Bethany. I mean, we're talking about days before he raised Lazarus. He already knew why he was going to do this miracle. He said in John 11, verse 4, when he heard the news, he said, "This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, for his honor, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." You know, I'm sure you all have aspects of your life that are not the way that you pictured it. And you've got a choice in those moments. You've got a choice. Am I going to bring honor to God through what I'm going through? Am I going to let go of manipulation? Am I going to let go of anger and bitterness and rage, possibly even? And surrender. Take a deep breath and surrender it all to God. And acknowledge that you are not the center of the picture, that he is the center of the picture. And you know what? I cannot promise that if you do those things, if you choose to bring honor to God, I cannot promise that the outcome of that situation is all going to be okay. Cannot promise that. Cannot promise a good physical outcome. But if you choose to accept that path of choosing to honor God instead of choosing to honor yourself, it'll be for God's honor so that God's Son can be glorified through it. And that's what we all really want. That's the prize. He is the center. That is the picture. Amen.
Good morning, family of God. What an honor to meet in your homes this morning to share God's word. And what a powerful reminder from James that God is always in control despite our circumstances. We now come to a time where we partake in the Lord's Supper together. I want us to remember the words of Jesus where he says, "It is for God's glory so that God's Son may be glorified." Whatever you may be going through this morning, we don't always understand God's timing and God's ways, but we do know that God will always be glorified in the end. Even when life seems to look like this is not the way we pictured it, God is always at work in our lives. So let us allow the events in our lives to shape us into His image and to transform us more into His likeness. Let us not try to manipulate and control, but rather allow God to take control and surrender to Him. He is, after all, our Creator and our God who works in mysterious ways. When I was about 36 years old and still very much single, I thought to myself, you know what, I am not going to try and look for a wife anymore. I'm happy to be single and, you know, that's going to be fine. And then within 1 year, just like that, God blessed me with a wonderful, beautiful wife that I can now spend the rest of my life with. Now, that is God's timing, not mine. We have to remember that God sees the big picture. So let us get onto God's agenda. And in this way, we can allow God to open the eyes of our hearts so that we can see more clearly who God is and who Jesus is and what His plan and purpose is for our lives. Let us also look to the cross and surrender everything to Jesus and know that through Jesus, God has given us His way into the eternal kingdom, where we can take part in eternal life right here, right now. Let us pray for the bread and the fruit of the vine. Father God, we thank you this morning, God, for your sacrifice for Jesus on the cross, Father God. Thank you, God, that through events and circumstances in our lives, you can shape our hearts and transform us more into your likeness, Father God. Help us, Father God, with whatever we are struggling with, whatever we are going through, God, and let us surrender it all to you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Good morning, church family. I trust that you enjoyed the Sunday morning service with us. And yeah, to Marlon, thanks for the communion message. And to James, thanks for the reminder that this picture, or the story rather, it's not about me, but it's actually about God. Well, thanks for that. So I have the privilege of sharing some good news with you as a family. And this good news is in the form of baptisms. So the following people were baptized this week. We had Karen Hewitt, baptized in the Northwest Marriage Ministry. Welcome, Karen. And then Tomiso, who's 18, was baptized on Sunday. Tomiso is the son of Andrew and Nosisa Kekana. Welcome to you, Tomiso. And then we had Eni Mosima, who leads the Hope Project in Polokwane. She was baptized on Saturday. And then some more exciting news from the Hope team. Nobushle was baptized in Durban. She is a part of the Hope Shield program. Welcome to you as well. So to Tomiso, my new younger brother in Christ, and my three new sisters, welcome to the family of God. Amen. And then to you who perhaps you're visiting us for the first time today online, or you've been checking us out online and you want to find out more about us as a church, you are more than welcome to contact us on the details which appears on the screen next to me, and we will respond to you from there. That's it for us this morning. I pray and trust that you'll have an awesome Sunday and a good rest of the week. Bye-bye.